So, I currently work as a data engineer at Le Bon Coin, and I became interested in programming 5 years ago after studying mathematics at university. And since I have been involved with several tech communities in Paris, and especially with women in tech. So now I am the co-founder of Paris, of Ladies of Code Paris. And if you want to join the group, you are welcome. And if you want to give some talk, you can come and join. It's okay. So, in fact, like Claudia, I was a tech addict, and in the past year, I enjoyed attending a lot of events in Paris to learn new language, new framework, and new tools. And also to share my experience and to share ideas with other developers. And because for me, being a developer is not only typing code, but staying curious, learning all the time, creating and finding new challenge. And being a part of those communities was always inspiring and motivating for me. But sometimes, when you stay too focused on the same thing for too long, I think it becomes difficult to innovate and to stay inspired. So last year, it's funny because Sheila explained before, I was in a burnout mode. And I tried to find a way to be kind of myself. And I tried to find something I really like. And I remember that when I was young, one of my dream was to travel across the world. So that's why last December, I decided to go away. And this is how Tech Beyond Borders is born. So Tech Beyond Borders, this is a trip across Asia. So I visited 6 countries, Nepal, Myanmar, Cambodia, Singapore, Malaysia, and Indonesia. Why? Just, of course, for fun. Of course, to take some nice pictures, discover new culture, but also I really wanted to meet tech and developer communities, and especially women in tech. And it was my first long solo trip, so it was very exciting. So, of course, before leaving, I had many questions in mind. So, the first one is, what is being a developer in Nepal? And do they have communities like us? Do they use the same technology, language? And, of course, how many women work in tech? So, today I'm going to tell you about something that surprised me. And also, I hope you will be as inspired as I am. Yes. Okay, so my first stop was Nepal. Has someone already been to Nepal? Okay. So, okay, if you plan to go there, I have just one tip. Okay, so in France, when you want to say yes, you do like this, and when you want to say no, it's like this, okay? But in Nepal, it's very different. When they say yes, it's like this. So it can be useful. And there is something else about Nepal. I don't know for you, but for me, Nepal was synonymous of trekking, mountain, and also one of the poorest countries in the world. And so when I explained to my friends working in tech that I wanted to meet developers in Nepal, almost everybody said, okay, but really, you want to meet developers in Nepal? Do you think you can find communities in Nepal? And everybody was surprised, but indeed there are, and there are many communities in there. So let's talk about being a developer in Nepal. Okay, the first point is electricity issues. So, in fact, there is not continuously electricity in Nepal. So, you have electricity from 8 to 12, and then maybe from 4 to 8, But this is in theory. So in practice, it's not really like that. So it can be really frustrating by not having power and not being able to charge your phone or laptop. And also, it means that you cannot organize your day, your life, your business like in France because of this issue. You need to invest in a generator or something like that. And there is something else about Nepal. It's political issues because this is a very corrupt country. So it's not that easy to have big industries and investment. So many companies are specialized in outsourcing or web development, and you have the same language than in France. But because of that, many developers want to go abroad. Some of them come back, but not everybody. And I just put some link if you are interested in going into Nepal. So there are main contributors, so Cloud Foundry and LeapFrog Academy, and some media if you want to see what is a media in tech in Nepal. Yes, so there are not as many communities in Nepal than in Paris, for example, but there are many, and it's growing. So it was a big surprise for me. So you have many, you would know them, Hour of Code and Startup Weekend, Ruby Meetup, and my favorite is this one. This is a community for art, tech, and science. And it was really, I was really impressed. This is music. This is a traditional stuff in Nepal, and it's connected. So now, if you want to visit Nepal, I think you can find all this community on Facebook. It's really easy, so don't hesitate to say hello. And there is something about women. Of course, there are few women in Nepal. It's around 5 or 10%. And there are also many initiatives to increase these numbers. So like girls in technology, women, women leader in technology, and women in STEM. But okay, all those women I met were impressive because they had many energy. And they really wanted to change the fact that I had a few women in tech. But I really appreciate to meet some men, because some men I met started some initiative. For example, this is a guy who founded Girls in Technology. And also, there is another guy, Saroj, the founder of the Ruby Meetup. And you know how it's hard to find women speaker for tech event. And he tries to find one speaker woman each time he organizes an event. And he doesn't hesitate to coach them. So I found it was a very beautiful example of inclusion. And in Nepal, it's not that easy for women because you have some arranged and forced marriage. And you also have a big bias. So I think it's cool to see those men acting like that. And just my feeling about tech in Nepal is I think people know that digital fields are a way for women to embrace and to be more free. And Nepalese developers are aware of that, and as they really try to include women. Okay, so now this is Malaysia. When I was in Nepal, it was in December, so it was really cold. So you can see on the pictures, everybody has a coat, the coat like that, really. So my favorite expression was, oh my God, it's too cold. And then I arrived in Malaysia. And my favorite expression became, oh my God, it's too hot. Because in Malaysia, it's humid, it's hot, it's humid, like today. Yes, because of the light. And there is a place where it's okay. This is this one, the green one. This is tea plantation. So if you want to not have, I don't know, if you want to have fresh air, go to Cameron Island, this one. And what I knew about Malaysia was a few things, in fact, but I heard that there were many women in there, many women like, I don't know, 40 or 15% of women in tech. So I was very impatient to meet those women and to ask them how they do to have so many women in tech. Okay, so this is a woman who code, Kuala Lumpur. This is the co-founder, all our co-founder. And okay, so I met those developers and women developers in Malaysia. But in fact, there isn't 40% of women in there. It's more like in France, 10 or 15%. And I ask why, where does this number come, 40%? And one girl explained me that maybe it's because of the call center, because there are many women working at call center in Malaysia. And then we talk a lot with those developers, all our developers in different companies. There are startup, monster, and we talk about what is being a developer in Malaysia. And then I realized that it was really similar to France, in fact. We have the same topics, I mean, same trendy topics, big data, DevOps, IoT, Angular. And the Malaysian government is involved with digital stuff. And also people want to learn to code because many people want to create a startup. So they want to learn code. So it was really similar. And I was a little bit disappointing because I think differences are more interesting than similarities. So I hoped in secret that the next country will be more different. And we had a fight with those girls, and because why are there so many similarities? And we thought it was maybe because of the US thing, because everybody is looking at the US ecosystem. Silicon Valley is a real model for everybody. And maybe because of that, all the trend come from the US. I don't know. So now this is Cambodia, and of course Cambodia is the country of smiling people with an amazing temple. This is Angkor Wat, and also you eat rice every day, at breakfast, at lunch, at dinner. So, yeah, so I cannot eat rice anymore, so please, yes. And also, there is something else in Cambodia, tuk-tuk. I don't know if you know what is tuk-tuk. I have a picture just after. Tuk-tuk is, this is tuk-tuk. Okay. So, okay, the ecosystem in Cambodia is still in early stage. And as you can see, there is not that much women again. But I met a very nice girl, and she's working on open data organization. So this website, if you go on this website, you can see some data set, open data coming from, you can find data set with open data. So I find it's funny. And also there is a media very interesting with tech in Cambodia. The name is Geeks in Cambodia. And it was also funny because when I met those women developers, I asked, okay, but why do you think that there is so few women? And she replied something very common for me. It was almost the same that we heard in France. Code is difficult, it's mysterious. And it's for men. And there is another reason, is about the tradition, because in Cambodia, there is still strong tradition for women. I mean, the woman have to learn how to take care of the house, get married, and they have to come back at home before 8, so that don't have the same possibility that men. So it might be explained why, maybe. Okay, so tuk-tuk. It's important for the following. Okay, so in Cambodia, I participated in an event, maybe you know, it's a Startup Weekend. Do you know Startup Weekend? Yes? Okay. For those who doesn't know, okay, this is 2 days, very intense, and you have to build your startup from scratch, and you have to define a business model, and you have to validate your idea, and you worked with people you don't know. So it's me with all Cambodian people. I was one of the 2 developers, so no women developers. And we worked on a nice application. It's took it easy because it's not always easy to find a tuk-tuk in Cambodia, in Phnom Penh. And it's not always easy to find a safe driver, in fact, because they are used to, how do you say, drink. And sometimes it's very expensive. They ask you a lot of money. So we decided to create the Uber for tuk-tuk. It was really nice, of course. And I realized that it was really nice because, of course, in Cambodia, the culture is different. The life is different, so the ideas are different. So people use technology in a different way than we do. And if you travel, I invited you to participate in a Startup Weekend in another country because it can be very, very interesting. And there are Startup Weekend in across the world, so yes. And there is something else I really liked in Cambodia. So this is Benoit. And Benoit worked in Toulouse, in France. And he left France to Cambodia last year to work as a teacher for Passerelle Numérique. And Passerelle Numérique is an NGO. And before talking with Benoit, I didn't know it was possible to involve with tech in NGO. For me, NGO was more about nature, disaster, or animal protection. So I think it's really nice to share his story because it can be a nice way to go abroad and keep working in tech. So you can have more information on the website. And there are some chapters in Vietnam and Philippines. And then come Singapore. So, okay. For me, Singapore was a big, crowded city, constantly on the move. But when I was there, it was very quiet. Maybe too quiet, I don't know. It was very, 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 very clean. And also very hot and humid. So, of course, Singapore is like, it's pretty similar to France, and I stay only 3 days, but I learned something I really want to share. This is a digital nomad thing. I don't know if you know what is a digital nomad. So, in Singapore, I attended an event, and that's where I met Nikki, a crazy girl. And she explained me what is a digital nomad. So it's easy. So a digital nomad is someone who works in tech, like a graphist, designer, developers, but he travels all the time, you know? So he traveled and he worked at the same time. So she was the first digital nomad I met, but then I realized that there were many. And I met other digital nomads in Indonesia. Almost done. So, okay, Indonesia, it was my favorite country. Yes, this is a country I really wanted to visit. And actually, in Indonesia, I met entrepreneurs, but there were also developers. And it was really funny because I visited the startup, and it reminded me the the Silicon Valley, the garage in the Silicon Valley, because the startup I visited had a room especially for the team, and the house was the house of the founder. So yes, this is the room. This is in the house of Nikki, the girl. And this is a developer team. So they work every day in this room together on the mobile app. And Nikki, she's a person I really want to talk about because she impressed me. She's really tall, I think like this. And she's a real businesswoman. She knows what she wants. And she is a founder. She founded the company at 25. And the thing is, I think it's very interesting the way she found the idea. So she's living in Jakarta, Indonesia. And she decided to go abroad 1 year in England as an au pair to discover new culture, to meet new people, okay? And then she realized that those people went to the cinema. Young English went to the cinema. Young English go to the theater. Young English show musical show. But in Indonesia, people don't. So when she came back, in fact, she decided to create a mobile app. This is Girls. And the mobile app, it gives you some. It gives you activities to go out. She wants to invite Indonesian young Indonesian to go out to discover new culture, to go to the restaurant. So she wants to impact, to change the country where she lives. And I think it's really interesting because she traveled. She had an inspiration, and she had an idea she maybe wouldn't have had if she had stayed in Indonesia. So this is the conclusion, but I want to say that if you want to stay in your comfort zone, if you only talk with people like yourself, if you are not open, not curious, you will be missing a lot of inspiration, and that's why I think diversity is so important, and that's why I made this trip, and I hoped I made you want to maybe quit your job to become a digital nomad, I don't know, and I hope I made you want to say hello and meet these communities the next time you travel, and maybe I should say when you stop by, because I'm sure you are going to buy a ticket right after the conference. So it's done, and if you have any questions.